Good morning, Highland. Good morning. Thank you for joining us today. Good morning if you're in the fellowship hall. If you are joining us online, we welcome you. If you're in the parking lot, we welcome you as well. We're going to open today with a hymn, How Firm a Foundation. So will you please stand and join me in singing, How Firm a Foundation, Ye Saints of the Lord.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us this morning. A few announcements. Skills and team survey, service survey. Nominating team has placed a survey in the vegetable. Please have this survey completed by May 28th. Keepers of the Kingdom Vacation Bible School is June 25th through the 29th. It's from 6 to 7:30. Spread the word. If you feel it on your heart to help volunteer, there's a website there to register online for participants and volunteers. So please be praying about that. Summer mission trip, July 23rd to the 29th. That's in Shelby. Sign up is in the vegetable, and the cost is $100. You can see Tim and Score about that as well. Happy anniversary, Highland. Next year will be our 70th anniversary, so let's celebrate. We need volunteers to plan and carry out a celebration, so you can contact Frank or Terry if you'd like to serve on that team. So, green cards in your pews if you're new with us, or if you have a concern or prayer request or anything like that, place this in the offering plate, and we'll be sure to pray with you or answer whatever questions you have. So pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for bringing us here together in your house, Lord, to serve you. And may we feel your Holy Spirit today moving in this church. Thank you for the direction we're heading. And just open our hearts and our minds. And thank you for your Son that died on the cross. Amen.
How do you like it? Shall we do this every week? These and the other balloons in the aisle up here are for the CEC graduation. They had some beautiful ones left over on Thursday after three graduations. And we had a joint decision to celebrate their graduations and to enjoy the beauty of the balloons in the celebration therein. So What an added blessing. I was noticing Beverly and Carmen were just nicely framed by this behind them. Yeah, but I don't look as good as I do video. So I got a question. Who here likes to fish? Do I? Okay. Who likes to fish? Let's say it again. Okay. All right. It's not always catching. Fishing is fishing. It's not always catching, but it's fishing. Who prefers salt water? Who prefers fresh water? So that's about half and half. It's interesting. I like to fish. I enjoy fishing. It's been a while since I've fished. I don't know hardly anything about freshwater. So I just stay away unless somebody really knows what they're doing to tell me. But here's a more important question. Not do you like to fish, but who in here would call themselves a fisherman or fisherwoman, if that's a word? How many in here would actually call themselves a fisherman? We got one that's brave enough to say that. That's good. That's good. I see a variety of people in here who like certain things and or participate in certain things that I like, maybe is a better way to say that. But I'm not proficient at any of those things. A lot of them. I mean, think about the difference between a person who likes to fish, me. I have equipment. I got the tackle. I've got rods and reels. I've got a tackle box loaded. It's so heavy that it broke the handle off of it, and I haven't replaced it. You know, I've got the stuff. I used to know what to do, but I haven't fished in so long, I wouldn't dare call myself a fisherman. Get my point? I can fish. It's sort of like I can play golf, but I'm not a golfer either. I'm not a fisherman. That's what I'm trying to get at. I like to fish in salt water. It's what I know about. But again, I don't call myself a fisherman. I was over at the Gully's house this week, and Austin was wearing a Big Rock t-shirt, and I've been watching that from afar because I have a friend in Moorhead City, and I saw the signs a couple of times that I was down there early on, I don't know, 15 years ago or so, and I'm like, wow. One of these days I need to come down here and see what actually happens, because they get some pretty doggone big fish that come in of all different kinds. And so we just got talking about being a fisherman or fishing, all that kind of stuff. And the reality is, in a lot of aspects of our lives, we kind of know how to do something, or we know a little bit about something, but we're not necessarily proficient or consistent in it. We don't go enough, for example, to call ourselves a fisherman. I like to fish. Someone said, hey, come on, let's go fishing. Even if it was in a lake or a pond or a stream around here, I'd go, sure, because I enjoyed time with people. But I'm not a fisherman anymore. I'm sort of like a runner. When I first came here 3 years ago, I was running a whole lot more than I do now. So now I just say I run occasionally instead of I'm a runner. You get the difference? You get the difference? There's all kinds of things. I'm learning how to do work on my car. I've changed brakes and rotors. I changed the headlights Friday. I was going to change the spark plugs. I just ran out of time, so I let someone else do that. But I am not a mechanic. You get me? You get me? I think there's a lot of things in our life that we can be like that. And if I wanted to learn more about how to take care of my own cars, I could go up to Wake Tech. And I could go through some classes. I could learn how to repair cars. But if all I'm doing is the occasional repair on my car, am I really a mechanic? No, I'm not. And that's the way it is in so much of our life. It doesn't matter if I have a certificate. Doesn't matter if I have been to class. If I yell and loudly and talk about, I'm a mechanic. It doesn't matter how much I say or what I do unless I actually carry it out on a regular basis. Doesn't mean I'm doing it every day. Doesn't mean that's my employment. But unless I'm doing something regularly, I wouldn't call myself by that name. There you go. Trying to work on people's lives instead of on their cars. Thanks, Jamie. I can take it another step further. I can subscribe to and read magazines about cars and how to make certain repairs. But again, if I don't do it on a regular basis, I'm not a mechanic. Well, what does that have to do anything with anything in church other than maybe trying to help fix some people's lives, which only the Lord can actually do? But it actually has a lot to say about being a follower of Jesus. Think about it. Many people say, I'm a Christian. I follow Jesus. But do they really? Do you really? Well, Frank, do you mean that I can go to church and give some money and get baptized and go to a Bible study and still not be a Christian? I would dare say absolutely. Thank you. Absolutely. What is a Christian? The term Christian is in the Bible. There are at least three times that it's used. And it really is the word Christianos, or a little Christ. It's used in Acts twice and then in 1 Peter once. And it simply means that you're a little Christ, or you are a partisan, someone in favor of Christ, or one who follows Christ. We like the term Christian. It's an easy term. But it is used for everything. We got Christian music, and we got Christian radio, and we got Christian books, and Christian magazines, and Christian bumper stickers, and Christian everything. But is that really a little Christ? Is that really exemplify what we mean when we say we are a follower of Christ? I prefer to use the term disciple or follower of Jesus, follower of Christ, because both of these terms are much more active and participatory. I mean, think of Christian. When you say Christian, it's kind of a static word or a passive concept. I'm a Christian. But to be a follower, you've got to be doing something, do you not? To be a disciple, you've got to be doing something. It's called learning. That's all discipleship means. Disciple means is a learner, someone who is pursuing knowledge about Christ or something. And I've shared this before, but I believe it's critical for us to understand the term and the concept of disciple so that we can understand the impact upon our lives when we say, hey, I'm a disciple of Jesus Christ. It's easy to say, I'm a Christian. I'm a member of a church. I may still have membership in a church in Charlotte, for all I know, because I was a member when I was a kid. I went through confirmation and joined that church, but I am not a member of that church. So I've given you these terms before to try to help, these definitions before to try to help you understand what disciple is. And I found a new one that I like even better. But mine talks about the concept of knowing. And in the Bible, knowing is much more than just head knowledge. It is actually knowing with a relational, kind of a love understanding. The Bible talks about a husband and a wife knowing one another, it's not just about they know who they are. You following me? There's a whole lot more involved in it. So I use that as my root. A disciple is someone who wants to know Christ, to be known by Christ, and to make Him known. Okay? So that's my knowledge and acceptance of Him and trying to develop a relationship from my side. But to be known by Him means that He reciprocates. He comes back to me. But then it doesn't stop there. I don't just, like on my marriage day almost 40 years ago, I didn't just say, I love you, and that was good enough. I said, I love you, and I want to spend my life with you. And that's what being a Christian is all about. Not just doing one thing one time, but being known and then making known. A friend of mine who's been here, Brad Thomas, says a disciple is an individual practicing, I love that term, the way to be with Christ, become like Christ, and do what Christ did. Or use Jesus to be with Jesus, become like Jesus, and do what Jesus did. I think that's pretty good. But I found another one that I actually like a little better because it gets the last part a little clearer. A friend of mine named Steve Harris says, a disciple, and I'm going to follow this idea throughout. A disciple is someone who is following Christ. Active, following Christ. Being changed by Christ. Do you hear that? Transformation. And who is committed to the mission of Christ. And that comes from the passage we read this morning. From Matthew chapter 4, verse 19. We'll look at that again in just a minute. But think about this definition by my friend. See how we stack up. Follow, to follow, is an active verb emphasizing the relational side of things. I'm following somebody. Not just anybody. I am following Jesus. And then it is an aspect of transformation, being changed by Jesus, by Christ. So there's that transformation. A lot of Christians don't get very far in that process of transformation. Think about it. How many people have you seen who've joined the church and that's about all they've really done? You don't see a whole lot of change in their life. Maybe their vocabulary is less than wholesome. Maybe some of the things they do or places they go or people they run with is less than wholesome. We should be transformed. And I like the Greek in these kinds of concepts. It's be being changed or be being transformed. It's an ongoing active process. And then the final thing is the missional side of it. Being committed to the mission of Christ. Now let's look at our passage here. If you'll pull up Matthew chapter 4, we'll look at that again. While walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, whom he later called Peter, and Andrew, his brother. And they were casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Simple, straightforward. And he, Jesus, that is, said to them, Andrew and Peter, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Now, don't go any further for just a minute. Follow me. That's the relational aspect of it. Someone who is actively following Christ is a disciple. Being changed by Christ, here he says, I will make you, I will transform you, I will teach you and show you how to be like me, and you will become fishers of men. So you will be transformed into a fisher of men. Not someone who knows about it, not someone who studies about it, not someone who goes to church and learns and talks and discusses it, but someone who is actually fishing for men. It's different. We don't always catch when we fish, do we? Fish for fish. Huh? Yeah, I do. That's fortunate. But we all have this as part of what we're supposed to do. So let's look at this for a minute. Let me finish the passage before I move on. Follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. Immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James and John. I'm assuming he said something similar to them. And they were in their boats, mending their nets. And he called them. And immediately they left their boats and their father, and they followed him. So he's got four disciples already. The first thing we want to look at, just go back to 19 for a little while and just leave it up there. The first thing that we want to look at is this followship, if I can say it that way. We have to follow Jesus. We have to prioritize that relationship, do we not? We have to prioritize. I talked last week on Mother's Day about becoming a godly woman first so that then that would help make you a godly wife and potentially a godly mother. But we've got to start with the prioritizing of our relationship with Jesus. We got to follow him. Now, what does that mean? Simple. We spend time with him just like we spend time with others. We spend time with him and others who will help lift us up and help us grow in our faith with Jesus. Many of us do this okay, don't we? I mean, as far as trying to follow Jesus, or do we really? Really? Do we really follow Jesus? Do we have a disciple-type relationship with Jesus where I am pursuing Jesus? This same friend, Steve, who gave us this definition today, wrote in some discipleship material some statistics, and he quotes, over 85% of church attendees will tell you they have never been discipled by anyone. Never discipled by anyone. That means we've got over 100 people here, but let's say 20 of you have been discipled. And I'm not talking about just going and sitting in a group. I'm talking about an active, intentional process of discipleship where two of you are studying Christ together. Maybe a mature follower, more mature follower, is trying to help a less mature follower, a younger in the faith, to grow. That's pretty sad. Steve, my friend, continues, all of the polls that he has seen are indicating that people who can't claim to be Christians do not have lives that are significantly different from secular people. All the polls. Now, I didn't go to look up all his research, but I trust him. He's a friend. I can think of one friend of mine. I worked, for those of you who know, I worked with church planting. I didn't actually start too many churches, although I did, but I helped 150 guys start new churches over about 11 and a half, 12 years. And I'll never forget sitting down with one guy. He's got a very large church in Greenville, North Carolina. And I was talking to this guy, and I asked him, I said, so what is your discipleship plan? What is your process as the leader and your leadership team, as the leader and leaders of this new, brand new church? What is your process for discipling people? Because I know you're going to see a lot of people come to faith in Jesus Christ. They're going to want to follow Jesus, but you've got to have a process in place. And he said, Frank, said, I'm just not sure. None of us have ever been discipled. My heart sank. This guy's getting ready to start a church and he's not sure how to disciple somebody because he's never been discipled. So while I couldn't disciple him like I would love to if I was close to him, I didn't live in the same city as him, I began a process of trying to challenge him in his faith to grow in a way that's reproducible. That's reproducible. There's no perfect strategy. Hey, we can't stop our lives and go follow Jesus for 3 years like the disciples did, can we? But there are things that we can do. I just was baffled by this man, young man's honesty, fortunately, but the reality, he'd been to seminary and still not discipled, been a pastor for a while, still not had a discipling or a relationship from somebody or to somebody. That's a travesty and a disaster for a church, for the church at large. Maybe a huge reason that the church, capital C, church in America and probably in the West, is in such steep decline in recent years is because we don't have a process of discipling people to grow strong in their faith. By and large, we don't seem to really know what we believe. And when somebody challenges our beliefs, it's hard for us to stand up for our beliefs and our values. I'm just saying, this is stereotypical. You may go, wait a minute, that's not me. So one of the things that I'm trying to put into place is, and I've used the acronym before, is GROW, G-R-O-W. It's a pathway for discipleship. God's got to be first. God first. GROW. God first. If we don't have God in our relationship first, then we're not a follower of Jesus, are we? We got to start with God first. Secondly, R, read the Bible. If we're not studying his words, how do we know who he is or what he says or how we're supposed to live? We have to read the Bible. Third thing we have to do is we have to obey the Bible. Fancy that. Right? Fancy that. When we say we are following Jesus, when we are trying to learn Jesus, that God is first in our life, then we ought to obey. Samuel said to King Saul, to obey is better than sacrifice. To obey is better than going through the motions. And then the last one, grow. God first, read the Bible, obey God's word, and then witness. Or share your story, share the gospel. Some of us are scared of witnessing. One of the things I'm trying to do is what I'm beginning to call a discipleship triad or discipleship trio. Arthur and Jackie and I had the blessings of spending about 8 or 9 months together in a triad. We would come together every couple of weeks. What have we read? What is God teaching us? How are we blessing our neighbors, those who are far from God, and sins that we need to confess to one another and hold each other accountable? Now I'm working on another triad. They're working on another triad. So there's 9 of us. I talked to somebody recently. They were like, I'd love to do that. I've heard about it. I want to be a part of it. So we're looking at another one. We need to do it. Ladies, I can't do that with you, but I can guide you in that. If somebody's interested, I'd be more than happy to show you what we're doing so you can start. But that's got to be, something like that has to be a priority if we are following Jesus. We cannot do it on our own. I used the illustration a while back. The preacher went to, a guy hadn't been to church in a while, so the preacher went to his house, and it was kind of a cool day, so he had a fire on the hearth. Preacher didn't say a word other than as he was entering, he said, I can't stay for long. Sat down, they both sat down, neither said a word. He went to the fire, took the tongs, and took one of the hot embers and put it off to the side. They just sat there a while. What do you think happened to the ember? It died out. It kind of went out. That's right. Just like that. It just kind of went out. After a little while, he went over and picked it up with the tongs, put it back on the fire, sat there just a moment. Then he said to his host, I guess I better go. Not a word was exchanged. Got up and got ready to leave. And the man said to the pastor, I'll see you Sunday. You cannot live a Christian life alone. We are meant to be in community. It's the best way to not only follow Jesus, but to move forward in the transformational part. Jesus said, come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. I will make you. I will transform you. You probably heard the rhetorical question, if you were arrested today for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? If you are arrested today for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Or would the prosecuting attorney and judge just laugh? Whew. That's a difficult question. I believe I have this passage up, Tyler, if you'll find it in Acts 4. I mentioned 2 weeks ago when I was talking about growing disciples as part of our vision. Love God, grow disciples, serve others. Peter and John were doing things. They had healed somebody. They were brought before the Sanhedrin, a group of Sadducees and Pharisees who made religious decisions. And they were brought before them. And after a little bit of conversation, they didn't know what to do with them. And they were talking to one another. And this is what it says. Now they, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and perceived that they were uneducated common men, they were astonished. And they recognized that they had been with Jesus. Can people recognize that you have spent time with Jesus? That you have been with Jesus? You don't have to go to seminary. You don't have to be a preacher. You don't have to teach Bible study. You don't have to have degrees or certificates or anything. Did you spend time with Jesus? And is he changing your life? That's what it's all about. They had been with Jesus. There's another verse I believe I have up there. And I like the English Standard Version most of the time, but I really like this. This is the Message Version. Where's Jason Dunlap? He's the one that brings that all the time. This is the only way to be sure we are in God. Anyone who claims to be intimate with God ought to live the same kind of life Jesus lived. The ESV says you ought to walk like Jesus walked. Well, we won't be perfect in it, Jamie, but we need to move toward that. We need to become more and more like Jesus. That's the whole point. I'll never be like Jesus 100%, but I am following Him, studying Him, allowing His Word and the Spirit of God to change my life as I understand more and more. That's the key in doing it intentionally, following Jesus, learning about Jesus, and letting Him work in our lives. Plus, it's part of the reason we want to come together as a body of Christ, as a small group like your class, the Joy class, but also as we can one-on-one with others or in small groups like I'm talking about. Friends, what about your life? Do you model the same kind of life that Jesus lived? At least to some degree? Are we choosing things different from the world intentionally so that we can follow Jesus and not the culture? That's hard. But that's what we've got to do, folks. We've got to leave the world behind and try to become more and more like Jesus. More and more. More and more. Not 100%. We'll not get there until we get to Him. But more and more. And then the third thing. We need to become fishers of men. That's the missional side of things. When was the last time you shared your story of faith with anybody? To be honest with you, this is one of the things, I see Jackie and Arthur both here, that we skipped a lot of times. How have you blessed someone far from God recently? Because a lot of times, what's blessed stand for, by the way? Begin with prayer. L, listen. Spend some time listening to them. E, eat. Spend some time over coffee or over a meal. S, serve first. Serve them, serve with them, or let them serve you for that matter. And the last one is share. So we usually could answer, well, I'm still praying for somebody. Well, I saw my neighbor, but we're not getting down the line very often. But that's why you hold each other accountable. So that you don't go, I think I'll skip that question. But you go, hey, I haven't really done much this week. Would you pray for me? Help me to pray. I'm trying to meet with my neighbor here and had a hard time getting with it. But pray for me. When was the last time you shared your story of faith with anybody? Maybe I should say, have you ever shared your story of faith with anyone? There was a time when statistics said that 95% of Southern Baptists, that's the one they did the study with, have never led one person to faith in Jesus Christ. 95%. In their whole life. I'm not talking about last week, last month, last year. I'm talking about ever. But you can't lead someone to Christ if you don't talk to them about Jesus Christ. Now, we'll share more. I'll share more about that in a couple of weeks. And Drew's actually going to help me one Sunday with some of the things that he does to open conversations. But we've got to be about blessing our neighbors, praying for them, spend enough time that we listen to them, eat with them, or have some coffee or tea with them, or strawberry shortcake. That was good. Or whatever with them. Serve them. Share with them. Here are some examples of missional relationships that I'm working with. Again, out of the acronym BLESS, I've been praying for some neighbors lately, and praise God, one of them asked me, hey, Frank, how about coffee? I was like, sure, I'll go for it with coffee for you. And he knows I'm off on Friday, so we went to have a cup of coffee. Guess who brought up the conversation? He did. I didn't even have to do it. I didn't even have to do it. I've got a mint right there, I think. Do I? I'm struggling. Is this open? I got this. Never mind. Got it. Sorry. So, had recent coffee with this neighbor, and he brought up spiritual questions. Wow. God, will you help me have a relationship with so-and-so so that we can have spiritual conversation? I didn't even have to ask. He did. What a blessing. All right, we have new neighbors. I'm on a corner. There are four corners, obviously. And there's new neighbors. They've only been there a couple of months. They're pretty quiet. Drive in and drive out, and you almost never see them. But I finally met them, started meeting them. Now they recognize and wave to us. I finally learned that they have a daughter that has a serious, potentially life-threatening disease. And every week they have to go treat them. I'm praying for that family and that child. Yesterday as I was driving somewhere, actually it was Friday as I was driving somewhere, she was waving to me as she was getting out of her car. Starting to build a relationship. That's early. But trying to build a relationship. How can I, Carmen and I, help this family? Because we can't go into their house. Immunocompromised. So we can't go into their house. But how do we do that? Another thing I'm doing. I'm on the HOA board. How many of y'all have an HOA? Oh, heavens. Well, y'all are the... I see Jake, but y'all are the HOA board, more or less. I'm on the HOA board. We got a lot of rules, a lot of regulations. It's kind of hard. And I served a year ago, thought we were moving, got off serving again. But the other day, we needed some things done. Hey, can anybody help me? So I spent 3 hours pulling up old, dead, or dying rose bushes. That was fun. But I got to know two of my neighbors better, right? How hard is it? Just spending time with them, serving together with them. It takes time. It's hard. It's often frustrating, but it is important. If I am going to be a follower of Jesus Christ, I have to not only say it, I have to be it. I have to follow him intentionally. I must allow him and his word to transform me from the inside out. And it is an ongoing process. And I need to be involved in his mission as a fisher of men. As we conclude this morning, let me return to my question that I was trying to raise. Based on Steve's definition, how many of you could answer positively, are you really a disciple? Don't raise your hands. But how many of you really feel like I'm a disciple of Jesus Christ, according to this definition? Are you following Jesus closely, making time for him, and giving him priority in your life? Are you allowing him to transform you by spending time with Jesus and learning Jesus? And are you fishing for men? Are you sharing the gospel of Jesus and sharing your story of faith? If not, then you need to ask yourself that question. Am I really following Jesus Christ? Jesus himself said, we were in the Sermon on the Mount, he said in chapter 5, 15 through 20, you will know them by their fruit. Chapter 7, 15 through 20, you will recognize them or know them by their fruit. And to others who called his name, Lord, Lord, he says, I never knew you. Are you a Christian? Or are you really a follower of Jesus Christ? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as I read through this passage and read through this material from my friend Steve and saw that definition and began to understand more fully what it means to be a true disciple, what it means to follow in the footsteps of people like Peter and Andrew and James and John and the others who were truly his disciples while he was on earth. Father, I confess that I am not walking fully and intentionally in all those ways. There are areas of my life that I have been struggling with for years And the fish in my cooler, so to speak, are very few because I'm just not fishing a lot for men. Father, I pray that you would move among us, that you would stir our hearts to hunger and thirst after righteousness, to seek first your kingdom, that we might become true followers of you, being transformed by you, and seeing men and women, boys and girls, caught with the love of Jesus Christ as we fish for men and women, boys and girls. I pray that you would move among us and stir our hearts and help us to be on mission, catching men for Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. I do want to take just a moment before we go into communion. Can you just play something? You can play Love Ran Red if you want. We'll sing that in a minute. I just want to take a minute to give you a chance in your head and heart to go ahead and address what God was saying to you. If you felt like God was saying something to you about your relationship with Jesus Christ, take a few minutes to let Him speak and speak to Him, okay? Let's just take a couple moments. And then I'll close in a prayer and we'll move into time of communion. Lord God Almighty, as we seek to love God, grow as disciples, and serve others, Father, help us to understand what it really means to love you and to worship you, to give you the worth, to the honor and the glory that is yours. And help us to grow as disciples as we can come closer and closer to you and become transformed by your Spirit and your Word and live it out. God, I pray as we prepare our hearts for communion that we have taken this moment to get right with you, to confess sins, and to seek to prioritize, Lord, in our hearts. Not just that we're far from where we could be, maybe should be, but that we're going to take steps to move in that direction. So, Father, I pray that you would forgive us and help us to walk more fully as your followers, your disciples, your fishers of men and women and boys and girls. And as we prepare to take of this feast, really, spiritual feast of your body and your blood as these elements represent, I pray that you would bless us and guide us in all that we partake of. In Jesus' name, amen. These are simple elements that we partake of today. But think of them as the gifts of God for the people of God. Take these in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on Him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. This wafer is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. May it keep you in everlasting life. And the people said, Amen. Thank you. at the cross where his blood was shed. This is the symbol of the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ that was shed for us as a new covenant of faith with God Almighty. As Jesus said at the Last Supper, "Take this cup poured out for you. It is the new covenant in my blood." And the people said, "Amen." We sing that chorus one more time. At the cross. At the cross.
Cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I own all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I'm
Before we close in a benediction, just a couple of things. You heard the announcement that May 23rd, 1954, 70 years ago, this church was founded. Some of you have been here the whole time. Some of you have been here a lot of that time, but we want to celebrate. So I need some help. Some people to take that on as a gift to this church, because I hope it will be a very, very special occasion with a lot of people coming to participate. So that's on the 70th anniversary. And as we close, thank you, Shelley, for those songs. I know some of them may not have been as familiar, but did you read the words? Did you pay attention to what those lyrics, those songs were saying to us about what Jesus did on our behalf? How powerful that was.
Let's bow in a word of prayer and go from this place as fishers of men and women, boys and girls. Father in heaven, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for your love and your grace. Thank you that you forgive us when we fail you. And you strengthen us with your grace to go from this place and to be fishers of men as we seek to be followers of Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.